So I am indeed Héloïse Petit, not John Force. Just to say a word, I'm actually a professor of labor economics at the CNAM, which is a French institution for continuous training in Paris, and a researcher at the CEET, Centre d'études de l'emploi et du travail, which also depends from the CNAM. Okay? Regarding my research, well, basically one of my favorite topics is labor market segmentation, and this is true since several decades now, so I can say it is one of my major investigating topic. What I'm going to present here is this article, Internal Labor Markets in Britain and France, which is actually an article still to be finished fully. This is why it's not, sorry for the discussant, I couldn't give them the full final version, but I gave them a previous version, which is actually a preliminary version of this work, which is taken from, the article I'm going to present here is building here on this article, which is chapter 4 from this book, which is tenure. The chapter book was Tenure, Skill Development and Pay, the Role for Internal Labour Markets. And we continue to develop the concept and the analysis that was done in this chapter, and which is now the article I'm going to present. I'm going to come back again on this book because it's actually some of the work we're building the article on is was already developed in this book, meaning the whole empirical setting, which is actually constructing a parallel empirical analysis between France and Great Britain. Okay? And we're building on two surveys, which are very similar. And all this building of the survey, building of the data set, is common to the several articles in the book. So I'm going to come back a bit on that. I actually had a copy of the book that I would have handed in to you, but I thought it was not very COVID sympathetic to have something getting hand to hand, so sorry. I can just show it to you, but basically I'm not sure it's a good idea to pass it through. Maybe, well, I don't know. No, basically not. Okay, so I'll come back on to the book. The motivation for the question I'm gonna discuss today is that actually empirical literature, I'm a labor economist, okay, so I've been working on different topics and not only segmentation or internal labor market, but basically whatever the subject, be it training, pay, contracts, working conditions, well, basically you find a lot of duality in the French labor market, okay, whatever you're looking at, well, you find high inequalities and differences, and well, basically, whatever the entry, I would come back in the empirical results that the good quality jobs would be in the same firms. Okay, those who had actually high pay were also those who had actually intensive training, good working conditions, good contracts. Okay, so whatever the subject you could come in, well, basically, you would find the aggregate in the same firms and the aggregate in the same workers. So this is a basic empirical grounding that, okay, called me into the question that, well, could we say today that ILM are still present? Okay, these firms which accumulate all the good conditions, are they still, can they still be called ILMs? And how, basically, do they compare with the previous version, the historical version of ILM, firstly discussed in 1970s. I suspect you already had teaching on these topics, so I'll kind of build on that. But if you have any question regarding to some things I would maybe go a bit too quickly, please ask. And, well, all along the presentation, basically, you can interrupt me and ask for any precision on one point if it's not clear. Please do so, rather than following on and not understanding the way I'm building the results. A second point in our motivation that was that, well, basically the labor market segmentation literature in the 1980s showed it was very fruitful to have international comparison. The first results were built on the American cases. you know about Doringer and Puri's work, which was actually field work in the Massachusetts in the end of the 60s. Well, basically, when we compare that to the actual functioning of the labor market in France, in Britain, in Italy, in Germany, we could find that in some countries, and especially France, you would have very similar ILMs, okay, working on very similar ways. But in other countries, basically, you had other forms of investment in HR, in human resources, other forms of building human capital. And basically, this is how the idea of occupational labor market arose for Britain and Germany. So in this literature, it's already been shown that international comparison was really useful. And well, I hope I will convince you that once again, it has been very useful for us. And we're building on this very rich comparative linked employee data set to run, which would make it really easy to run this comparison. It was a lot of work to build this comparative data set, but once we have it, it makes it more easy to do the comparisons we wanted to do. So the presentation outline I'm going to follow is first develop a bit more on the context and research question we are building on. Second, a point on the data we're mobilizing and the methods we have defined. And the way we defined internal labor market, the empirical definition of internal labor market. In the first point, I would rather go back on the theoretical definition we choose to rely on. And in the section on data and method, I will give you the empirical translation of the theoretical concept we wanted to build. The third point would be trying to have, let's say, a topical portrait of ILM. What do ILM look like today? Okay, once we define them, let's look at them really and take seriously the way understanding, do they work in the same way as the 1970s ILM? Or basically, how did they change? Because we know the world has changed since then. Last point is looking at which firms actually do put in place ILMs. And this will lead us to the last end point, which would be discussion and concluding. I'm sorry, I'm a bit short of breath, so because you're nervous, so I have to speak loud, but if it's okay for you, and especially for the first row, I'll take my mask off. Please feel free to maybe get one or two rows behind, if you're more at ease with that. Also, know that I had the COVID just 2 weeks ago, so normally I won't have it today. So, literature and context. Well, the first historical point we're standing on is that, you know, let's say there were a first phase up to the 1990s, let's say from the 1970s to the 1990s, where the concept of labor market segmentation was very widely used and a reference concept for anybody who would talk about the labor market. And even if it emerged in institutionalist economists, it actually, at this date, during the 1980s, it's been widespread into also the neoclassical framework. So it was really everybody would use the concept up to the 1990s. As I said, you would have different national version. You would have international labor market for France or the US, but also for countries like Britain and Germany, the notion of occupational labor market. Basically, I don't know if you heard of those. Did you? Not sure. Because they're kind of obsolete now. But basically, the idea here was that you would build in careers in occupation, at occupation level, okay? Like builders, and go from one firm to the others, but then staying in the same occupation. And building on training for the German case and building on unions for the British case. But I'm not going to go too much into this literature because it's not our topic today. The common ground for be in Britain, in France, and other European countries since the year 2000, basically, and the end of the 1990s, There has been a lot of literature about the decline in international labor market. Okay, the main idea was, well, we would see less and less role for seniority criterion as a paying device. We would also see a decline in apprenticeship, which was the base for occupational labor market. And these two main changes, raised a lot of questions about the accuracy of this segmentation concept. And at that point, basically, a lot of people were saying it was the end of the story for segmentation. And I don't know what, this is exactly the point where I decided to do my PhD on that and try to see if it was any more and still useful to hold on to that framework. Well, as you would guess, if I'm still working on it after my PhD and a few decades after my PhD, that, well, basically, I kind of argue that the shift away from the concept of ILM is more the consequence of a persistent reference to an outdated version of the concept. Okay, because it was so successful in the 70s, the representation of the ILM that made Doringer and Puri, it marked a lot of the idea of what would be an ILM. And once we changed basically to a service economy, this typical manufacturing ILM just was thought as obsolete. Okay? But my argument would be here that it's this exactly empirical definition of ILM may be obsolete, but it won't be the case for the whole theoretical framework. But to keep with a dynamic version of labor market segmentation, one that can hold from the manufacturing economy to a service economy, basically then we have to stand a bit further from the empirical definition and go to a more theoretical definition of ILM and of labor market segmentation. So as an introduction here, I would propose you to come back to a more conceptual definition of ILMs and of segmentation, because I think this is a precondition to be able to still use the concept today. The theoretical definition of ILM first. Next slide would be about segmentation's dynamic definition. But let's turn first to ILMs. Well, basically, if you turn down to the core characteristics of these firms, they are firms that offer more than market conditions to their workers. You know, Doringer and Puri were studied as economics in a time when they had basically neoclassical economics in hand, and they would go to firms and be very astonished that actually firms wouldn't pay like market wage and would actually be differentiated from the market. Okay, so the core point here is that basically firms, some of them at least, in their decision, in their human resources decision, stand back from the market and decide for internal reasons. Okay, if you remember the original version of the definition of ILMs, internal labor market, they would say they are unit within which pricing and allocation, which are the function of the market, pricing, wage, and allocation from one firm to the other. And they would say that ILMs are units where pricing and allocation of the labor is governed by internal rules, okay? But they would call them administrative rules and procedure, but this is kind of outdated in the terms. But what I would keep from that is the idea that it's internal rules that account and not the reference to the market. Okay, so the idea that for some firms, when they want to decide how much they're going to pay their workers, well, they will have a first reference into their internal coherence of their human resource policy and not the specific reference to, okay, what would this worker be paid outside and just pay the same? Some of the firms would, but not all. Okay, so that is the way, let's say, the core definition of ILM I would propose. And the second part of it would be the idea that ILMs are career-building vehicles. Quite surprisingly, this idea of career is central to any description of ILMs, but never appears in any theoretical definition. So here I kind of propose to set it in front, set it in the heart of the definition, because, well, a career existed in the 1970s. Today, the concept is still accurate, but it will actually change in its form. But the idea that some people in the labor market, in their working condition, can have a career, meaning they can progress, be it in terms of working condition, wage, opportunities, whereas some others won't progress in their working time, in their working life, meaning they will basically have nearly all their lives the same wages. Okay? Even if they're in a stable employment, they would basically stand for low wages and just set to that for their whole career. Okay? So the way internal labor market demarks here from other firms would be the idea that they offer the means for career. Okay? This is the idea behind this notion of career building vehicles, meaning they give the opportunity for careers. Okay? And this notion of opportunity is more open, obviously, than the definition you would give in the 1970s, where you would have very predefined career path. Okay, so here I'm standing back from this very predefined career path, but keeping the idea of career building, the idea that some firms do offer the opportunity for a career, and implicitly some others won't. So the ILM firms would be those that give the means to develop a career, meaning progressive improvement of working and employment condition. Another important point here is that such policy does not say if your career should be inside or outside or interfirm. Okay? Because another point that really stood as central from the 1970s definition would be the idea that ILM would mean internal career. Well, basically, even in a 1975 article, if I remember right, but definitely in the 1970s, Michael Puri already wrote an article saying, okay, you have two types of careers. Some of them are external. Okay, they're still the primary labor market, but they actually happen from one firm to the other. And he would call that the superior primary labor market. Okay, so here I would argue I'm still aligned with the historical concept when I say that talking about an internal labor market does not mean that you are falsely talking about internal careers. Okay, even, of course, if the term internal can be misleading here, but internal can be a group of firms. Okay? And then you would allow for career going from one type of firm to the other. Because, and you have this sort of subset of firms where you would go from one to the other to build a career. Okay, so is it clear for this new proposition and definition of internal labor market? Yeah. No? Yeah? Was it a question? Oh, good. Second point about the redrafting of the theoretical framework that we propose. Well, here is more about the segmentation as a whole. Okay, obviously, it's different to talk about internal labor market, where you're focusing at HR policies of firms, and to talk about the whole labor market and the way it's structured. And here again, there's a very important legacy from the segmentationist approach, is that they would consider that employers' policies and practices are the driving force in shaping the labor market. Okay, and here is also a very important mark that would differentiate this segmentationist or any institutionalist approach from a more classical or neoclassical one. In the neoclassical framework, you would basically have a symmetry between employer and employee. Okay? Different economic conditions, but a symmetry between actors. Here, you have as a basic point in the analysis the idea that firms' policy, firms' practices are the driving force. Okay? doesn't mean that the worker can't have any choice, but workers' choices are made in the context of what firms offer, okay? So firms actually create the context in which workers act. This is the way you could interpret this idea of driving force, okay? And this is, by the way, the reason why segmentation approach built in the US has known such a success in the French labor economist vein of research, because this French labor economist vein of research was very marked by this idea of labor demand as a driving force. Okay, so here is a main connection between the two and why this concept has been very fruitful in France. Well, at least I would argue so. So this is the first important point, firms as driving force in shaping labor market. And the second, which is basically a subsequent point, when you connect the two first ideas. The first idea is some firms do create ILMs. Second idea, well, firms' activity, firms' practices do shape the labor market. And how do these two connect? Well, basically, this is the third point here, saying that only some firms will actually want or be able to, this is a real question, but I'm not going to address it here, but only some firms will create ILMs, okay? And it is from this differentiation that would be grown, or that would deduce segmentation of the whole labor market. It is because you have two types of firms that actually they would connect to two types of workers, meaning some workers won't have access to these firms. Okay, these firms creating ILMs, they would enable only some type of workers to get inside them. Okay, and this is the way they shape the labor market. Okay, they won't allow any type of worker to get in the labor market, and there is a sort of selection, well, not sort of, but a selection between type of firm which creates these segments. Okay, and basically in the basic heuristic device of two segments, you would have one with ILM firms and workers entitled to get in them, that would be the primary segment, and firms with no ILMs, and the workers who can only get there, which would be the secondary segment. Okay, so importantly, it is because some firms have ILMs that you can deduce the existence of segmentation. And of course, they're not doing it on purpose. I'm not, a whole point here, and we're not gonna discuss that, but it would be that, of course, this is like a side effect of HR policies of some firms. Okay, we're not talking about a compotist version of firm policy saying they are doing this with intention to segmentate the labor market. Of course, this is not the idea. But the idea is that as a consequence of the fact that they're having an HR policy of investment in their workers and that they only accept some kind of workers, well, this would end in the happening of segmentation. Okay? So here you have, with these three concepts, a kind of more dynamic intertemporal definition of labor market segmentation. And for the rest of the article, what would be crucial is this notion of the way we define internal labor markets. Okay, so firms that would enable careers for their workers. If you remember one thing for this introduction, this is the crucial point. So, yeah, still concluding from the two previous slides, of course, I conclude from them that it is still relevant to speak into labor market segmentation and to still use the concept of internal labor market and labor market segmentation. And I'm not the only one, basically, to do so. So here are some references of other scholars who do. And another precision in this paper now, not generally in the use of the concept of labor market segmentation. In this paper, we will focus on ILMs rather than looking at the labor market segmentation as a whole. Okay, it's actually quite difficult empirically to look at labor market segmentation as a whole because you need a lot of information on firms' HR policy and information on worker movements. So basically, it's very difficult to have the two at the same time in the same data set. Okay, so you always have to come in from one side and try to have a glimpse at the other side. So in this paper, we focus on ILM, and we focus on those ILM that would enable internal career. Okay, as I said, the more general definition that I propose here allows for internal or external careers. But in this paper, because of the way we empirically defined ILM, we focus on one type of ILMs, those enabling internal career. Okay? And the research question we're raising here is basically, well, what is the prevalence of ILMs in Britain and France? Can we still find any? And basically, can we find any in Britain where the concept has always been seen as not very adequate to understand the British labour market, even in the 1970s? Remember, in the 1970s, when we would apply this concept to labour market segmentation in Britain, you would focus on occupational labour market, meaning empirical work at the time would downplay the notion of internal labour market in this context. So it's quite nice to have the two together, that we can contrast a potential difference in the two. And basically, the second question is, what would be the shape and the contours and the driving force of actual ILMs? Okay? Because, of course, the argument is to step away from the old style definition. Well, what are we going to find? And what would be the shape of today's ILMs? And what we have to bring to this debate, what assets basically we come with in building this article? Well, first asset is this dynamic interpretation of ILMs, which actually opens the way for the further analysis. The second asset we would have was the richness of our data set. Of course, whenever you want to test the empirical accuracy of a concept, you have to find the right data that goes with it. And here, I would argue, we have the very good and appropriate data set. And the third point is, the third advantage we would have to run this analysis is our comparative view. As I said, it is a very good way to put forward national specificities. Remember when I said, in the French case, I tend to find inequalities whatever the dimension of the labour market I would look at. But to some point, you can just argue that, okay, if you're looking at inequalities, you would find some. Okay, but comparing countries is a way to see if it's specific or not in one country to have that. Okay, now some word about the data set and the empirical method. So the data set, it's a combination of two surveys. One is Réponse and the other is WERS. I don't know if you heard of any of them in any other conference. No? Well, okay, so I'll have to present them. So they are linked employer-employee data sets, meaning they are surveys with questionnaires sent to employers and other questionnaires sent to employees, and we can connect the information from the two, okay? We have approximately, here you have number of establishment, 3,000 for WERS, 1,000 for WERS, around 3,000 for Réponse, and the number of employee questionnaires that are sent and that can be connected to firms is 10,000 pretty much in each country. Okay, so a lot of information on with two sides, meaning that when we want to know what's happening in one firm, we have two entries, okay? We can connect two point of views, and it's more than two, actually, because we have more than one worker for each firm. Okay, we will have one representative from the directors and at least two workers per firm, okay? For empirical reason, I will quote later, we actually kept only those where we had at least two questionnaires for workers. An interesting point of this survey is actually that the French survey has been copied from the British one, meaning that the questions are really close. The first French response survey was from 1998 and was made to be alike the worst one, okay? So this does not say that it was strictly comparable, the same questions, and directly translatable, but it was very close, closer than any other type of survey of this scope. Another point is these surveys have very wide scope, meaning they have a lot of questions on HR policy, but also on industrial relations, and also on the way firm, the competitive setting the firms are in. Okay, so various dimensions. Also work organization in the firm. So the kind of, I don't know, it's like a 50-page survey. It's really a lot of information for each firm that we have. There's a link here to a web page where we actually give full information about the translation of each survey and how to connect the two surveys. And I left it here because it's free to use, and you have all the startup program to run the two face-to-face and with an exact definition of what questions are comparable or not. And so please feel free to have a look at it, but also to use them to have comparative analysis on the two surveys. Since 2011, there has been a new response survey in 2017, but no new work survey yet. Okay, so it's the last year for which we could have comparison. We could have it also for a previous 2004 version that was also very close in time and content for the two surveys. Okay, but no new one yet. We still hope that the next survey for WERS will happen and hope that it will be in line with the next response survey, but that's not sure at all. The scope of analysis is private sector, and it's from establishment with 11 employees or more. Okay? One important point is because of the construction, employee data only concern employees that are at least 15-year tenure. Okay, so all the employee questionnaires we have are from workers who are in the firm since at least 1 year. Okay, so this has to be in mind when we look at the stats for these employees. We don't have very short contracts, basically, here. But it's also a guarantee that they know well the firm they're talking about. Well, I was talking about the empirical definition of ILMs that actually, is more precise than the theoretical one. The empirical definition we proposed is that we will define as ILMs firms that combine high wage and high tenure. Sounds very simple, but it's difficult to operationalize, I'm not sure you can say that, this such definition, because basically where would you put the threshold for high, and could you take only high wage, or do you have to get a high wage and high tenure? Our point is we want the two of them, okay? And another point is, okay, maybe it's high wage only because they have old workers very qualified, okay? So we want to get rid or control for individual characteristics to see really establishment effect on wage and tenure. So to do so, we have a two-step method. And the first one is we defined workplace fixed effect on tenure and workplace fixed effect on wages. So I don't know if you're aware of these kind of techniques. Well, basically, it's econometrical analysis of tenure and wage, so two regressions, where we control for individual characteristic, gender, age, education, gender, age, education, and tenure, okay? Because we want to cross the two information. We want high wage given tenure, okay? We want firms that have the two specificity. It's not only important to have tenure. You can have very long tenure in a bad job just because you have no other opportunity, okay? What counts here is having tenure in a good job, basically in one where your wage increases all along your tenure. So from these two equations, we deduce the firm, well, establishment fixed effect, okay? Would mean, because we have several workers per firm, we would see, on average, how does tenure in this firm differentiate than from what would be expected given the individual gender, age, and education, okay? How does this firm would differentiate from what would be expected given the individual characteristic of their workers, okay? So would be firm supplementary effect on wage, or firm not supplementary, can be specific, but can be minus, of course, can be negative or positive. But basically, it's a firm's effect on wage and firm's effect on tenure. So we combine these two establishment firm's effects. I'm going to go quickly on these. And we define, the second step is that we define ILM as the workplaces which are over the median on both fixed effect. Okay? Those for which the firm effect is positive is, sorry, those for which the establishment effect is over the median on tenure and is over the median on wage, okay? So then do better than others for these two dimensions. And one point is, remember I told you about France and you would accumulate all the good effects. So at some point, it was obvious for me that the two would accumulate, okay? And you would find high wage in the firms where you would have high tenure. And indeed, it is what we find for France a lot. But as you will see, it is not true in the same way in Britain. And basically, that would say that in British firms, well, some firms have high wages and others have high tenure. And those that connect the two dimensions are much less frequent than in France. Okay, and so this gives you a fresh look at the French case, meaning it's not tautological to find the good quality job in the good paying firms, etc. You have this cumulative effect of good properties is not by nature, is not tautological. It is some choice of firms. And indeed, we have this workplace with high wage fixed effect, and these workplaces with high tenure fixed effect, and ILM would be only those crossing the two characteristics. And you would see that in France, this is 38% of workplace. Please try to not pay too much attention to the level of the 38%, because it's totally by construction. What is interesting is the comparative level with the UK, and the idea that when you have 38 in France, it's only 15%. In Britain, okay? So it's not normal to overlap high paying and high tenure, okay? It's some specificity of the French case. And actually this overlapping is much less frequent in Britain, okay? So this is what's important. Yeah, I mean, the total level, you would have to keep in mind that we're only on workers on firms with 11 and more employees, okay? So it's difficult to interpret the 38% in absolute value. What is important is really the comparative point. And you have the corresponding share of employees. So now let's last point before looking at the characteristic of these ILMs. Let's characterize the workers working in there. So here, as I said, we don't have enough information to look at worker mobility. Is there a real segmentation? But what we can look at is, do workers in these firms have specific characteristics, or are they as any other workers? Okay? We can't have a dynamic interpretation, but even in a static lecture, in a static analysis, we can look, are they specific? And indeed, they are. This is, you don't have the full results here because it was just not stand in the case in the slide. And there's other results to come. I have to kind of hurry anyway. But what we can see is that workers in internal labor market are more often male workers, older workers, have higher education, and are in occupations with high skills. So, well, if we want to put it in a word, we would say that these are the workers with basically the highest bargaining power in the labor market. Okay? So still, this hints at the existence of a segmentation effect that would keep away from being in an internal labor market other workers, women, younger ones, those lower educated, etc. Okay? This hints at the idea that there is segmentation. It's not a proof. Okay? It hints at the... it is an element in the sense that there would be some kind of segregation in entering these ILMs. At least we can see that they have particular profiles. So this is in line with the hypothesis that the labor demand segmentation is fueled by a segmentation of the labor supply group, okay? And that the two connect and actually fuel each other. So now that we have a definition of ILMs and their workers, an analysis of who's working there, let's go further into the portrait of these HR policy of these ILMs, okay? Now, as I said, we would expect that they don't have the same kind of very stable, very easy to anticipate career path. But now, let's look a bit further about what's happening. The first result is, well, we do find that these high tenure is due to less frequent quits. And this is the first important result, because it means that firms actually are, the policy they have enables that workers don't go away from them. Okay, so this again is in line with the older definition of ILM, which is it's not only that they don't dismiss the workers, it's that they their policy is such that people stay and want to stay. Okay, the reason for stability, the reason for tenure here, is not because they don't dismiss workers, it's because people stay there. Okay, and quits are less frequent than elsewhere. So let's look at more. How do firms get these results? How do they get workers to less quit? We will see what are the incentives based on career opportunities, those on pay policy, and those on voice mechanism. Here, we're going to look at the, for each practice we're going to review, we're going to look at the connection with the fact of being an ILM. So we're going to look at the frequency among ILM firms and among other firms, and we're going to test the difference. Is the difference in the two stats significantly different from zero? I'm just pointing here that we're not doing a regression, because we don't want to look at things, other things being equal. We want to look at how characteristics accumulate in some firms. Okay, so we don't want to control for any characteristic. We want to look at basically which characteristic goes with the one of being an ILM. So let's look at incentives through career opportunities. So this idea of internal career. As you would see here, for some question, we don't have direct equivalence from the two questionnaires. So we kind of have different questions about the same topic that we put face to face or next to one another to talk about the same subject. Okay, we don't always have strict equivalent in the two questionnaires. On this question of internal promotion, opportunity for internal career, on the British side, so the first three, four columns, and the French side is the last four columns. For ILM, then the question, for example, here is only existing in the WERS questionnaire. So we only have information for Britain. It's not available for France. And the idea is our vacancies, so it's a question to the employer representative, are vacancies filled internally by preference? Okay, and what is the share of workplace who do say vacancies are internally filled by preference? This share is 42% among those firms defined as ILM. Okay, meaning as 42% of the firms defined as ILM do actually prefer internal filling of vacancies, whereas the share is 30% in other workplaces. Okay, so you have a plus 12, a bit more of plus 12 difference between the two ratios, the two frequencies. Okay, the last information here is a p-value of the significance of this difference in frequencies. And here, as you see, it's non-significant because it's 0.13, and we usually take 0.10 as the threshold. But here we have a more large interpretation, and we kind of look at results that are near the threshold because we only have 800 firms for Britain. Okay, so we can we argue that we need a sort of loose appreciation of this threshold here. But basically, you would see that it is much more frequent in ILMs. And similarly, in French case, you have much more firm ILM firms that do say that employee has been promoted in the last 3 years. This is actually from the employee questionnaire. Okay, employees are asked, were you promoted in the last 3 years? And what are, according to you, your chance of promotion for the next 12 months? Okay, and we interpret that as information about the existence of possibility for internal career. And then from these three line of results, we argue that these show that basically there is opportunity for internal career. Okay, so this goes in line with the idea that we have long tenure with progression in wage, and basically we see that in these firms you have promotion in a more general sense. Another point, this was how is a new vacancy filled. Another information is,
because I don't understand vacancy filled internally by preference, is that the company decide where to put the workers?
It's basically when you have a vacancy for a job, do you first try and find someone inside your firm, okay? And obviously you can't have only this solution, but you prefer this solution, okay? So basically, we interpret that as okay. They give. You remember the idea as ILM as career building vehicles. Like okay, this is some place where you basically could make a real career, meaning progress in your work content. The other point is basically when they open a job, what kind of job do they open? Okay, do they open a job in part time or in short term contracts? Well, basically what we find here, and it's significant in the two countries, is that ILM firms tend to have more permanent contracts and more full-time contracts. Okay, so we also interpret this as another hint of that these firms do fuel the possibility for internal career, okay? Because they tend to offer better quality job in even if you accept this kind of general definition of quality, which is just contract length and working time. What about pay policy? Because I'm kind of running out of time, I'll go quickly on this one, which is basically the idea that they have seniority pay more than others and in the two countries. Okay, that's a quick sum up of this table. And the ILM firms have seniority pay, especially for very long tenured workers, though there's 10 years or more. Another interesting point here is this result on another point of view on pay policy is not in terms of level or not in terms of seniority pay, but in terms of pay scheme, okay? So do you have profit sharing schemes or share ownership plan? Do workers own shares of the firms? And so this first set of questions is about how the worker can be associated to the firm's interest in their pay, okay? With part of their pay being held in shares or being linked to the profit, firm's profit. And the last lines here is more about, these two last lines is more about individual payment, performance pay. Okay, individual level performance pay. So these are basically more of an incentive device to workers. And what we can find in terms of ILMs here is that, all these characteristics are typical of ILMs, but only in France. Okay? So here is another important difference between our French and British case. Whereas in the first questions, it was really pretty much similar, maybe a little less significant in the British case, but similar. Here, it's really some characteristics that do appear in French firms, but do not appear in British ILMs. And actually, this is something that was already studied in terms of performance pay. There's a lot of work by David Marsden, I don't know if you know him, that actually he worked a lot on this, on the fact that this type of pay schemes were very developed in France and not in the UK. And he basically argued that it's a lot about employment protection legislation in France. He also argued it's about a lot of employer networking in France, and also the legal framework, which the French legal framework really favors this type of pay. But let's go a bit further quickly on, are there characteristics of these ILM firms? Well, here, sorry, I'm going to go like in a nutshell conclusion about these results. You will have the slides, basically, if you want to go more precisely, now that you know how to read these tables. But let me just summarize the results. Here you see that ILM firms in both countries have more union workers, more unionized workers. Okay, union rates are higher in these firms. And you have, at the share of workplace, more union representatives, but also non-union representatives. So you have the general idea here is you would have space for voice. You know about the Hirschman exit voice alternative? Well, basically you have low exits here, but you have space for voice. So it's totally coherent with Hirschman representation of the alternative between the two. And it's also coherent somehow with what was found for ILMs in the 1970s, that they were locus for more union presence. Another point about skill development, which is obviously an important point. What are the opportunities to develop your skills when you are in these type of firms? Basically, what we find is these are firms, ILM firms have more on-the-job and off-the-job training. Okay, so more opportunity for continuous training, so for skill development in the firm. Another important point that appears more in France than in the UK is the presence. It's the presence of teamworks. Okay, so here it's more about work organization. So it's about autonomous production teams, about problem-solving groups. So how much voice do workers have in work organization? Okay? Union would be more about how much voice do you have in employment conditions. And here they also have a voice more important in ILMs into work organization. Okay? The opportunity to have an advice on that. So basically what we can find is with all these characteristics put together is that except for pay policy and for work, whatever is linked to work organization, meaning teamwork here, the characteristic in terms of training, in terms of promotion, in terms of the opportunity for promotion, and in terms of presence of union, well, we have some features here that are very close to old style ILMs, basically. Okay, so it would take different forms, but also a lot of similarities would actually come out. The last question is which firms put in place ILMs? But I kind of think I don't have time for that and maybe jump to the conclusion. Just two sentences. here we have a multivariate analysis, so a probability estimating the probability to be an ILM and looking at firm characteristic. And we first have structural characteristics, meaning size, sector, age. And second, we have competitive setting, like characteristics that give information about the competitive setting, like market size, share of the market, competitive dimension, competitive strategy. And what we can find overall is that what is mostly determinant in the probability to be an ILM are the structural characteristics.
Okay, these ILMs are large, old firms in some sectors, mainly these ones, and this is pretty common to the two countries. Okay. Just if you want to read it this more calmly after that, what I underlined is what is more marked in France. Like the F is underlined, and some sectors it's typically a more French sectors for the ILMs, and same here is for Britain. Sorry. So they're in a little different sectors, but also has to be linked to the fact that the two economies have very different sectoral organization. And an important point here, and this is maybe also very, not also, this is quite common to what would be expected in the 1970s ILM already, okay? Manufacturing, of course you also have finance and business services, which are of course not typical of the 1970s, but you have large firms, old firms, manufacturing that is here. But here we have some results that actually stand a bit differently than what we would expect from the 1970s version, which is ILM firms are not very dominant in their market. Okay? They're not leaders in their market. They have lower than 50% in market shares. Whereas we would expect from the 1970s version, we don't have the equivalent empirical analysis that can ground this expectation, but we would expect that in the 1970s we would be facing very dominant firms. So structural characteristics seems to be the leading force. And once we control for these, because here we're in a regression analysis, so we control for structural characteristics when we look at these competitive characteristics, well, these firms are not clearly dominant in their market. Well, still, for French firms, they have a spot on competitive strategy on innovation, quality, or generality. That is has to be linked with their HR strategy with a lot of training, and this is coherent. But I will conclude, the full conclusion, we'll come back on this conclusion. Just to have the full conclusion, well, basically, we think this empirical analysis do fuel the idea that ILM profile is still accurate. Okay, even the narrow version of internal career ILMs still has some accuracy in the French and British labor market, and much more in the French labor market. In these, stability and high wage is combined with internal form of careers, and you have HR practices associated to that, but you have work organization that is different from 1970s ILMs, and also in France, pay policy is different from 1970s ILM. Okay, so you have some difference, but still the bulk idea that you have internal careers is still there. So the next point is, do we want to favor these? Because obviously they seem to be good opportunities for workers and enabling them a nice career. So in terms of public policy, do we want to favor the development of these type of ILMs or not? Because of the low would be a bit harsh, but they don't seem to have a huge competitive advantage in the competitive market. So maybe this downplays the interest for these profiles, but still is a question. And if we want to fuel them, if we want to favor them, the next question is how? How can we? The comparative analysis here can help on this question of how, of public policy, because we saw that differences in the shape of ILMs in the two countries can be somehow linked to public policies. As I said, like the pay schemes and the fact that we have a lot of share ownership plans and profit sharing is definitely linked to the legal framework in France. So that can be a hint about how can we support these kind of policies in terms of legal framework. So here again, I find that, as I said in the introduction, I think this article is kind of an argument about how comparative analysis, having two countries, help us to point what is specific and what can influence the situation in one country. The last point I want to address, or just raise, maybe, because it's the last sentence of the last slide, so I can't say we completely address it. But here we pointed at some ILMs that are those favoring internal careers. But as I said, in a wider or intertemporal dynamic framework that we propose, well, basically, you would also have the room for inter-firm ILMs. And then, well, maybe we want to find a way to look at them, and maybe these are the ones that would be on the top competitive, top side of the market. And then we want to see how we could fuel this type of ILM rather than internal ones. Okay.
First of all, thank you, Héloïse, for the presentation, and thank you for the text. We really enjoyed to read it, and maybe there will be some overlapping in our slides because we had to summarize and you presented a lot of what we will also present here. Then we will try to go a bit faster on those parts. Then we'll talk today about the internal labor market and new comparative evidence. It will be me and Aulia that will make the presentation. Then in the first section, I will make an introduction of the research itself. And then Aulia will talk a bit about the ILM characteristics. And then he also will talk about the new trend, about the declining of ILM rates. And then I will try to make a link between ILM and feminist economics. Next slide. First, the introduction. The text starts with two main hypotheses. Then the first one is that for an understanding of what happens to economies and to workforces is incomplete without knowing what happens within and across workplaces. Then the text itself try to have to go deep on their analysis and could have a more specific and micro analysis in that sense, really looking for the workplaces and for the employees. Then the second hypothesis, it's that local conditions, including national institutions, play a key role in shaping how employees work and think and think, and how employers recruit, dismiss, and manage employment relations. And it's a very institutional approach to say that the institutional arrangements can influence very much the decisions also from employees and also for the managers and for workplaces. Then about the sample, I will go a bit faster on it because Eloise already presented. Then it's two different questionnaires that it's based on the research. The first one is the British Workplace Employment Relations Survey, the WIRS. They take the data from 2004 and 2011. And the second one, it's the Franche Enquête Relation Professionnelle et Négociation d'Entreprise. Sorry about my French skills. It's not that good, but it's a response 2005 and 2011. Then the sample Charelli talked about it. It's a very big sample, also about workplaces and also about employees. There is some the size. It's different between 2011 and between 2004. On 2011, they took employees with companies workplace with 11 or more employees, and on 2004. They took only companies, workplace with 21 or more employees. And also about the tenor for the response, they took employees with more than 15 months of tenor. And for the WIRS, they took employees with 1 year or more of tenor. Then some strengths and weaknesses, some advantages and drawbacks about this approach. First of all, it is a large sample than cross-national data that it's made by European Union and so on. Then we can look better on these specific examples. then we can have contextualized comparisons. The data from employees and their workplaces managers can be linked. And we can have, with this kind of data, have a better understanding of the structural characteristics, the ownership patterns, and the management practice. Some drawbacks, maybe, it's that the survey has not been explicitly harmonized. The extrapolation is difficult when you make a case study. And both surveys exclude the smallest workplaces, and the harmonized employee sample excludes short-term tenure. Next slide, please. Then there are some theoretical assumptions in the introduction. The first of all, it's about imperfect markets, imperfect information of the agents, institutional arrangements influence over market decisions, that non-agents are fully rational, have fully rational behavior. They can act across fairness, prejudice, or pursuit of happiness, and et cetera. That institution cultures and social practices shape the framework of economic actions. And there is an observation that I would also like to present. It's that if there would be competitive markets and firms oriented only by efficient solutions, then firms and employment relations should not differ across countries. And it's not what we can see in this example. Then it's only something to prove more this theoretical background. And next slide. Now, Aulia will talk a bit more about the island-oriented workplaces.
All right, thank you, Rodrigo, and thank you, Professor Héloïse, for your presentation. Now I will summarize this one because you already talked about the characteristic of ILM-oriented workplaces. So I just summarized these 7 points. The first one is ILM-oriented workplace encouraging their employee to further their career within the firm, whether it's by ongoing skill development and opportunities for career progression and opportunities to develop skill through on-the-job training. And they have a strong employment protection. Also, they have high level of job tenure, payment of above market wages, large size firms. And also you mentioned they mostly old firms, and they are predictable product demand. And they have presence of specialist HR, and they also have a union memberships. But this mechanism, or old definition, you said that this has lost relevance in recent years. And also it has to include not simply administrative rules, but also social practice and customs, as Piore 2002 said that. So I will put in this discussion here. I got from the class by Professor Antoine Ribeiro in corporate governance, but in your text, you say that ILM workplaces both in France and UK are more likely to be foreign owned and less likely to be family owned than other workplaces. This is might be linked to the financialization argument that increase in top executive compensation is increase the heterogeneity across the firms. This increasing firms heterogeneity might also be the case that increasing inequality in individual earnings right now. As Piketty said that the primary reasons for increased income inequality in recent decades in the rise of the super managers. Wage inequality increased rapidly in the US and Britain because US and British corporations become much more tolerant of extremely generous pay package after 1970. So this might be a new discussion about wage inequality. Furthermore, it's my observation that employer-employee data might not completely capture the individual characteristic of the firms, especially their specific governance, because The key insight in the island perspective is that organization as the locus of the employment outcomes. And the most important decision regarding wages and employment are made by organization. And this is also from Professor Antoine. Market structure, technology, or skill specificity industry are not enough. It is important to see behind the story the nature of the firm, like board composition, the equity ownership. So I will present the, just I found the data about declining ILM in France, UK, and US. This is the data that I found between 2005 and 2018, the trend that happened across sector in UK, in France, in socio-professional labor firms. This is because firms rely less to internal recruitment or reorganize skill structure, especially when it comes to increase the share of high-skilled workers. This is the data from Maureen and Signorelli, 2019. And also in the UK, it's same story about this is possible explanation about this might be the effect of firm digitalization on the relative demand for technical versus firm specific human capital that automatization and currently might happen the digital diffusion in the firms around the world. So I will pass to Rodrigo for talking about feminist. You are muted.
Thank you, Aulia. And then passing for some parts of the text, I think that you also approached it, that in line with the literature, we find that males employees, old workers, and those with a high level education are particularly likely to be located in workplaces with ILM orientation. And there's also another part that Britain, for instance, has a much higher rate of part-time work, which is particularly prevalent among women. Then about the first part, we can assume that ILM companies are usually the best work positions and are really the best jobs available in the labor market. And those companies with the are very ILM oriented, then they use still to contract mostly male and older workers. Okay, that they are also highly level educated, but there is a very gender and age segmented. And also, there is in this part of the text, there is no reflection about what the feminist economics says, that women usually tend to work more in part-time job because they are also used to carry all the reproductive jobs in the householding outside of the market. Then maybe some data in the next slide for the next slide, please, Aulia. For the Global Gender Gap Reports 2021 of the World Economic Forum, it's that women represent only 27% of all manager positions. And it is estimated that it will take 267 years to close the gender gap in the world. Then another part of this of the text of the Professor Héloïse, it's that together works with high-skilled, with colors, white-collar occupations, manager, professional, and technicians account for half of employees in the ILM type workplace in France. Then I would like to maybe ask what are the relations between ILM oriented companies and gender inequalities? I think that it could maybe provide good insights about it. And also if are there other inequalities gap within ILM oriented companies? For example, I would be very interested to know if there is a racial gap or racial inequalities or maybe ethnical gap and discrimination within those kind of firms and what it can say for the broader market, labor market itself. Then we made some questions for you, Professor. Aulia made the first two and I the last two ones. Aulia?
Okay. My question is, as I say, declining ILM trend in also in France and UK and also in US as a result of rapid diffusion of digital technology and also rise of gig worker outsourcing, automatization, etc. Which policies you think that should be implemented to encourage firms to open up career ladder? And the second one about ongoing debate on increasing wage inequality, also the new phenomenon of the great resignation that happened in post-pandemic situation. Do you think it's correlated with wage inequality within the firms? And what is consequence in the global labor market?
My question for you, it's could ILM be useful for the investigation of broader labor market conditions as a precariousness of work, discrimination, productivity, outsourcing, etc.? And how are the links between the legal arrangements development and the ILM development? Because we can see that there are decreasing in ILM firms. Maybe is there a link with the legal arrangement within those countries? Maybe when the work conditions, legal arrangements became weaker, then also the companies follows it and we start to be less ILM oriented. Then, yeah, those are my questions. Thank you very much.
Can you still hear me? Well, kind of look like you don't have it. Okay. Okay, thanks for your reading and thoughtful reading and questions. I'll try and then answer the question you explicitly raised and connect them with some of the argument you made in the discussion, because they are obviously are connected. Let's first address the first one about the change in digital technology and the link and the link with ILM. Well, basically, I think here, in a word, there is a need to differentiate between these different technologies and their impact. You can't just consider strictly similarly the impact of gig economy, outsourcing, automatization. There are tendencies that might happen in the same firms, but might also not, and actually do concerns also different firms. And to take them the 3 points separately, if you look at the rise of gig workers, then I would have, let's say, two level of response on that. The first one is, well, if you look at platform economy, you're still looking at a very small part of the labor market, okay? So very marginal situation in terms of labor market functioning. But then if you're looking more generally at how it connects to interfirm and outsourcing and the wider organization of the production process, then my guess is you would be more looking at firms that would have interfirm labor market, interfirms internal labor market, because these new type of functioning actually rely a lot on transferable skills and do evaluate this transferability. So it would be the fact that you have been in one other firms, one competitive firms that will be valued when you get inside another one. So definitely this may be the ground for this new type of interfirm ILM, and the fact that these type of profiles definitely seem to have increased since the 70s. Earlier I made the point that they already existed in the 70s and were appointed by Pure in the mid 70s, but definitely this does not mean that nothing has changed. I'm kind of insisting on what did not change, but it's not to say that nothing has changed. And basically this idea, the predominance and the prevalence of this interfirm career definitely has developed, and specifically in this gig economy. The impact of outsourcing and automatization would primarily happen on these
old style internal ILM, I would argue, because they're more these two last dimensions are more concern more manufacturing firms, and basically then they would have different impact. Outsourcing, well, not so different maybe, but the two of them would mean a shrinking of the size of these ILM, and the idea that they tend to nowadays focus more than before on high qualified workers. As you pointed, the share of highly qualified white collar qualified workers is more than 50%, and definitely this is not what we would expect to find if we would look at 1970s ILM. Okay, so here one impact would be a focus of these internal career ILMs on most qualified workers, even on blue collars. It would be more qualified blue collar workers because of outsourcing. Okay, the less qualified blue collar workers would be outsourced to other firms. So same consequence for automatization, I would say. But okay, so this also links to the second question on the linked with inequality and inter-firm inequality. Basically, the idea, one important point about these internal version, internal career ILMs, the one I'm pointing in the article, was that because they were larger and would focus on less qualified workers in the 70s, there would be a driving force to the lowering of inequality. Not that they seem to have focused on the most qualified, obviously this focus would fuel the increase in overall inequality, meaning that those less qualified were now out of these ILM and do not benefit from the reduced inequalities that is expected to be inside ILMs. Okay, so this change in ILM and their frontiers obviously fueled and goes with increase in inequality overall. This also links to the third question on general labor market condition. But one other point I want to make about the results on less and less internal recruitment. Okay, basically the idea is not, or what we show does not is not contradictory to these dynamic transformation. Okay, it's just to say that okay, there has been a lot of focus on this dynamic interpretation. Such a focus on the idea that there is less and less ILMs, to a point that like nobody would expect to find any today. Okay, so the idea has to be taken in that context. Okay, the idea that we would expect no more firms to enable internal career and fuel these internal career, well, we point that they still exist. Okay, and to this point, it is not totally out of scope, but it's not as pregnant as before and cannot have the same central role in modeling the labor market, even if it would still follow in the segmentationist approach the idea that they would shape part of the labor market, but only part of it, in terms notably of inequalities. And this brings me to the question of the link with gender inequality. And well, there is a complete coherence with feminist economies and segmentation economy, interpretation of the economy, of the labor market namely. And the researcher who studied that the most is Jill Rubbery, and who really pointed at that point, at that question. And her work with others really pointed the idea that, is coherent with that idea, also developed by Berger and Puri in the 1981 book, that you kind of have a double segmentation of labor supply and labor demand, and that actually it's on purpose. I don't have the right word, but it's no question that it's obviously both inequalities are fueling themselves, and the fact that the ILM firms will focus on those workers who already have the most bargaining power in the labor market is no hazard. Okay, they connect, and it is because they focus on these workers that they actually can that they have this segmentation impact and this this impact on inequality. Okay, and the fact that women are still on a side of the labor market where they have less bargaining power explains largely how they are less in these ILMs. They're less present in these ILMs. And about the role for interpreting labor market conditions overall, I think it kind of raises another point that is important, that is that tenure is not enough. Meaning that we tend to consider that, okay, especially in the French debate, there's such a focus on short-term contract that the idea that whoever gets a permanent contract is okay, whoever gets a stable contract is even more okay. The point is here to insist on the fact that it's not enough. Okay, some jobs have a permanent contract, have very long tenure, but in such a poor condition that they just replicate frustrations for years. Okay? And this is a part of the labor market that basically hasn't been in any focus since the rise in unemployment in the 1980s in France. Because 1980s, 1990s were such a period of rise in unemployment and in short-term contract, this has been totally at the center of all focus in terms of public policy. And to my argument, this would be a reason why all the people, like middle-class people in jobs that are stable but very bad conditions, just next to the minimum wage from the start to the end of their career, and which actually fuel a lifelong frustration, has been just out of scope of any policy. And, well, one important thing about looking at labor market segmentation is actually to put forward this secondary segment, which are people which are in the job, and not only those that are in secondary because of very short-term contracts, those that are in secondary job, but stable secondary jobs. So it's some kind of what is most interesting in terms of public policy is, of course, the shadow of internal labor market, is the fact that some are not in there. And of course, you raised the connection with corporate governance and the specificity of these firms in terms of corporate governance. Of course, it's part of an understanding of who they are, which firms are concerned, and definitely it is connected to the way their governance is designed. Well, there's one indirect link with, well, not so indirect, there's one link with what I've said here is about the role for worker voice. This is part definitely of the construction of the governance of the firm, is what room is given for worker intervention in the definition of the future of the firm. And well, here it's what it is, it's not a co-determination, but there's more space for workers' voice in these firms than in others.